What do you want? Leave us alone.
That's right.
Hey, there it is. So it's the ArtCast with Jeff Lafferty and Jibber Redinger. And we're here doing 100 Days of Comics. It's day 39, I guess. We work for 2 hours a day. Every day, getting our comics done. How's it going, Jibber?
It's going. That's for sure. What did you say? What day was it again? Day 38? Day 39?
Day 39.
Day 39. One more and we've hit day 40. Come on, man.
Yeah.
10 from there. We're on 50. That's the halfway mark.
Yeah, that's true.
And then, you know, plenty of time to quit.
Five more times of that 10 and we're at 100.
Yeah, and we can quit anywhere after that.
We can quit anywhere after that?
There you go. After 50.
That's safe.
He's an accomplishment. So if we got halfway there.
Yeah.
Milestone quit.
Yeah.
So.
Well.
How was your day?
It was all right. It's kind of busy. Got everything mailed, which is nice. And I actually got a little work done. Worked on that other project a little bit. Sprayed this piece out. So I got actually a lot of work done. What about you?
Messed around in my garden a little bit.
Oh yeah.
Cooked dinner.
What'd you have for dinner?
Chicken tortilla soup.
Yeah, that sounds pretty good.
Yeah. And then I messed around with some song.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's pretty neat. Did you give us any hints or clues or anything?
I don't know. It's like a drum guitar piece with like a little background keyboard filler. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just was feeling it, I guess. It had to happen.
Just feeling the music, though.
I guess.
Yeah. That's neat, though. At least you got
I sent it to you earlier, but I know you're scrambling, getting on like me, like, oh, so.
I saw the picture you sent me, but
I sent you two pictures in the song. Not a song. It's just a minute. It's like a riff.
It was wedged right in there.
You know, just figuring out a riff.
Cool.
Yeah. Wow. It's like sometimes you'll listen to something, you'll think it's like, man, that sounds good. Then you listen to it the next day and you'll be like, oh my God, what the hell was that?
Really?
Hell yeah. You start believing it sounds good.
Do you ever go back on that though? Like afterwards, you know, like a couple days later, you listen to it again. You're like, oh, no, that was pretty good.
Yeah, sometimes. I don't know, man. Yeah, I get back and forth with it.
I do that a lot with my art. I look back at stuff I thought was terrible and I gave up on it a little bit. I want to do that. It's good enough.
See, you know this, Jeff, that I was rushing to go out, ran outside real quick and sprayed this down so I could have it to paint on.
Yeah.
One, I painted like this area, especially right here and like right near, way too dark because I was doing it in the dark.
Oh, no. A lot of detail.
Yeah. But what was the other thing? And the other thing is I did it with spray paint. And it stinks.
Yeah. That's the thing about that damn spray paint, man.
So I'm gonna point out my paint here. Frank's in the chat.
Maybe I ought to go stick that thing outside for a bit and sketch for a half hour or something, but grab it back or something.
You know what I am, and you know what I'll do? I'll just put me in hard headed and I'm going to paint this.
Oh man, power for
2 seconds.
All right. Hey, Frank, how's it going? Oh, yeah, you're pushing the mailing list. You know, I should stop sending the mailing list out. I need to start a new mailing list. The mailing list was causing me too much trouble. I haven't sent it out for, like, a long time, and that was kind of my old mailing list. So, like, as soon as I started sending it out again, I started getting all these commissions. So I was like, you know what? I need to stop sending out this mailing list because all my old fans are seeing these new videos, and they're like, hey, I wonder if Jeff's got some time to do something.
And I'm back.
I was just talking to Frank.
Yeah. Any update on the search for Kevin Cross?
Yeah, I haven't got to that yet.
See. I think he's being seen all over the internet. There might be all sorts of crazy sightings.
That'd be cool.
The ear's out, man. Yeah, like, word is on the street.
Roping hog tying and bringing back to the hundred of the comics. Kevin, we can't live without you.
There it is.
Tell us what to do.
Yeah, give us another chore.
Yeah, exactly. And it'll be like the 100 days of cold showers. No.
Oh my God. I remember when he was doing that. He was like, no.
Yeah, man. That's pretty intense.
Oh yeah, that's rough.
That's a hell of a way to get up in the morning, I bet.
It's invigorating.
Yeah. Well, I've watched other guru types on YouTube that do that though.
Really?
That cold shower thing is like sort of like this. I don't know what you call it. Like purging thing or something, and I don't know if that's where he got the idea or what, but it sounds crazy to me though. What I get kind of tired of is like 23-24 year old dudes like on YouTube, they're all ripped, like telling me how to stay in shape.
There you go. Yeah, right.
At 50 years old, I'm like, dude, you got no idea, man. At 23, you could pretty much do anything to be in shape. So I don't know who you're trying to impress.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean, though?
Yeah, yeah. You can eat Slim Jims as your fucking main meal and have six-pack abs, you know?
I pretty much ate pizza and Qdoba burritos until I was 35. And, you know, I was pretty much in shape that whole time.
There you go.
So Frank makes movies in the chat. I wasn't planning to join you tonight, but the wife got up to use the bathroom and found a palmetto bug. So now I'm wide awake.
Uh-oh. He was on the hunt.
That's funny. And he says, I meant the other Frank. You mean the original Frank? Boy, they're going at it. I don't know what's going on. There's a lot of Franks that are. Says, hey, the other Frank is here too. Oh, that's what. Yeah, I get it. Too many pranks in the chat right now. So one of the pranks that I inked the mini comic I did for the Mini Comics Exchange. Oh, I like that better. The Mini Comics Exchange. Super simple.
Is that official?
Yeah, that's way better than the Copper Top. You know, blah blah blah.
Jeff's officially renaming it now.
I'm just giving my opinion. But.
No. I'm giving mine too. Jeff's officially renaming.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Salazar says he's over there watching some of Kevin's early videos. That's cool.
There you go. See if there's any clues in there, like the Vinci Code.
Yeah.
Give out tips.
Where his location is. That'd be fun.
Yeah, man.
We should do that one night. Do a deep dive on Kevin Cross. Watch a bunch of his videos.
There it is.
Let's see. I ain't.
Tonight might be tonight.
Salazar said we changed it. That's awesome. Yeah, eventually I think somebody's going to come to their senses and be like, this is the worst thing ever. Marsh asked us to change it, LOL, so we made it simpler. That's cool. I didn't, yeah, I just kind of get my head wrapped around it, you know? So I'm glad you guys did that, because I'm sure more people will join now.
Try it.
I just wanted to say, the Mini Comics Exchange.
Woohoo! There you go.
Maybe I
go
should
join up, people. Go join up.
Maybe I should. Yeah, definitely. Abe's here too. Maybe I should. I don't know if this would be cheating, but I could print out that little comic I did in the front of the 100 Days of Comic anthology and just send that out as a comic. I'd probably be against the rules, not doing a new one.
Look at you. Look at you.
I just want to be part of the club, man. Been waiting for 10 years for this damn Mini Comics dump truck to start back up. And I'm going to miss it.
You're going to miss it. You just got to put something together, dude. Come on. Don't sleep at all.
I can't.
You're wasting about a good 4 or 5 hours sleeping, Jeff.
I really hate like Monday and like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday is such a pain, even though today wasn't bad. But like Monday, it's like I gotta ship like everything that sells over the weekend. So it's like I'm busy packaging and taking stuff to the post office, you know. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Staples and I was goofing off looking at stuff in there. And I spent so much time in there that I didn't make it to the bank. And then I got to the post office and there was a gigantic line. So I actually brought some stuff back, like the stuff I had to take up to the counter.
Uh-oh.
But then, yeah, then on Tuesdays, it's like I got to go to the grocery store because that's like we're out of food and stuff. And then on Wednesdays, I got to go have lunch with my dad because that kind of like takes up, you know, like 3 hours. It's like the whole beginning of the week is kind of like shot as far as like during the day stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm complaining about nothing, I guess.
But you can get a...
Grocery shopping is a pain in the ass, don't you think?
Yeah.
I got to look to the refrigerator, make a huge list, and... I liked it when I was younger, when I just basically stopped by the grocery store every day and just grab whatever I wanted to eat. Now I don't even got a plan, though.
Wow.
So Frank, he's like, now that I'm up, he's really putting a guilt trip on us.
Well, we better be entertaining, dude. Yeah. Get entertaining now, Jeff. Start cracking the jokes out.
Okay, so he says, I will be done. Yeah, I will be done with my submission. Well, I do have one joke. I don't know if I should do it.
Oh, yeah, well.
This might clear out the chat. They're probably going to hate me after I do this.
Here we go. It's about time, Jeff. Hold on.
Yes.
I don't even know what to do.
Remember when I was talking about the Whisper Network?
Uh-huh. Actually,
let me clear out Frank's comment. Well, anyway. So we got in trouble about the Whisper Network. The Whisper Network actually found our smart ass post and started making fun of us. So I had to up the game a little bit. So now whenever we talk about the Whisper Network.
Yeah. There you go.
So when that happens, we gotta get to our post. Get ready for those bitches. Anyway.
Now, you're up now, Frank. If you were thinking about something, you ain't now. Wake up, people. Wake up.
Okay. Anyway, so Frank says, I'll be done with my Facebook banner this morning. Jeff Lafferty, how would you prefer me to get it to you? If you want to, you can just send it to me in Facebook Messenger, you know what I mean? That'll work. Or you could post it in the Rcasters if you wanted, whatever's easier. Or you could email it to me. I don't know how you usually contact me, but I think you're on Facebook, so that's probably the easiest one. dang on the Main Street now. Yeah, I know, it's weird. It's like, should we show it? I guess we could show it.
Yeah, you should. You should pull it up, dude. We should.
Yeah,
Randy we should view the canceling.
Yeah, exactly.
Let the canceling begin.
Yeah, Randy sent it to me. Otherwise, I guess I wouldn't have seen it. Because I did go over and see that chick who posted it, and I was already blocked. So I didn't even get, to say hi, and she's already blocked me.
Yeah, you don't even, yeah. How dare you, Jeff? How dare you?
I know, that was quick.
Oh, so,
yeah, Randy sent me this. So it's Renthamus, this chick's name. He says the white wing chin strap gargoyles of pop culture found out about a private Facebook group where women in the comics industry talk to each other, and they're losing their goddamn minds over it. It's beautiful. Hashtag pontificators. And then if you look, there's, I guess, my Twitter thing when I was sharing this video. The Whisper Network. A hydra-level chick organization determined to bring the world of comics to its end.
All right. Good job, Jeff.
I was pretty proud of that, yeah. And that's what it is, too.
You should be now. You should be now.
I should be what?
You should be proud of it now with this sweet repost.
Compared to these other ones, we are exposing the arrogant female Whisper Network run by Gail Simone and Alex DeCampi. Pontificators, the Whisper Network exists and seeks to destroy. That's not as good as mine. Let's see, Moroni Todd said that one. And then superheroes seeming less manly lately. Jacob undercovers one reason for it. The Whisper Network, a group of feminist conspirators intent on canceling even liberal male artists. Yeah, even the liberal male artists are in trouble.
Yeah.
AKA Sean Jordan Murphy. He'll be lucky to get out of Indiegogo with his $200,000.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully he hasn't dated anybody in the last 10 years. And then this other one, which I guess this guy's just reposting the Bleeding Cool article. This is one of those menacing laugh moments. They're using scare tactics to get their way, which is bad or worse than what they are accusing. But what I think is kind of funny is it's like, we were just joking.
Yeah.
And she's like, they're losing their goddamn minds. I mean, you know, you're telling me it was like a surprise that there's a bunch of cackling hens somewhere on the internet, you know, bitching about men. I mean, that's just like a joke to us, dude. It's like, we pretty much knew it.
Old news.
So let's see.
Well, that's why I made that new one. I don't know if it was, I sent it to you because I figured that one might need to go through censorship.
Oh, that other one you sent me?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was classic. Should I hit the alarm again?
Yeah, I don't know, man. Nothing is worse than this energy drink I'm trying to guzzle down.
I know. I'm not going to do that. Let's go, but I am going to show your thing. I didn't get a chance to put it in there. But.
Oh, that's fine. I like that one you did. That one was what's up.
Well, you gave me the pictures.
Yeah.
This one. God, I hate to even read this. Like people calling the Whisper Network, where we are crushing careers one penis at a time. Oh! That's Jibbins doing that one.
What? Of course.
Yeah, Salazar says the Whisper Network knows about us all, us now.
Well, you know.
And then Frank says, yes, message on FB. Okay, sounds good, man. And he also says, up, I'm pulling my eyeballs up the ceiling now. I really want to play it again, but I'll refrain. I'll refrain until we have a real, what do you call that?
Alert.
Alert, yeah.
Exactly. We have a Whisper Network alert.
That's right. It's a, I really hope more are coming.
Hope more are coming. There you go.
Why did she block me? I mean, I never even talked to her. I didn't get to say, hey, hi, how's it going?
Because she doesn't associate with people like you, Jeff.
Yeah, they're already canceling me.
There you go. Canceled.
It's the cancel culture that, you know, everybody complains about, that Ethan Van Sciver rags about all the time. I've been canceled.
Getting canceled like a sitcom, Jeff.
That's that quick.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't even feel like I got, you know, whatever.
What you got? What you're like 38 days back in, dude, and already this is bad.
Yeah, I wasn't even back on the horse, and I'm already knocked off.
Right, canceled.
Yeah, I wonder if I'm like the first 100 days of comics guys to get canceled. I don't know, maybe.
Maybe. Well, if not, yeah, maybe that's something to achieve.
Yeah.
First, tell everyone to put on their headphones, then blast the alarm. Yeah, I'm wearing headphones.
Yeah, I gotta watch you.
That woke me up, dude. I should have done, man. My heart's racing. I'm a scared little rabbit.
Well, you sent me a few more that were pretty darn funny.
Oh.
Is that another one? Did I say that? But that was the funniest one. Well, I'll go back and find it later. Maybe when I go over to your house, I'll go look at them.
Yeah. I haven't put that one in yet.
But yeah, I had that dry
one yesterday.
Yeah.
Got old Scrooge McDuckin going on.
Oh, yeah. I forgot that. Yeah, that's another good one.
Yeah, I got that one up. I got back on a, I guess, second wind or something. It's like, man, gotta make some more of these. Gotta make this happen.
Tortilla soup fired you up.
It is, dude. It fired me up. The tortilla soup.
Yeah. That's all I was missing.
Yeah, I'm back, people. That and the power of energy drinks.
Mm. Hey, did your headache finally go away? I forgot to ask you that.
Yeah, it did.
That's good. What do you think it was?
I don't know. I think I was dehydrated, and then I think I had a little bit of a caffeine headache at the end.
Yeah.
With their powers combined. Life sucked.
Well, I know. You know, it's like, it's kind of horrible, but I was reading on Twitter, actually. This guy, Otis Frampton, I don't know if you know who he is.
I don't know anybody.
But he's like,
at least.
He's an artist, yeah. He used to do sketch cards. That's kind of how come I used to pay attention to him. But he also does comics, web comics and stuff. I guess he ended up getting a brain tumor.
Oof.
And but he just got it out. They like cut it out of him, and I guess he's okay, which is crazy.
Yeah, that's wild. That's wild, man. Well, I hope he's doing good.
Yeah, me too. I don't want anybody dying for a brain tumor or anything.
Yeah, I was gonna say like what? Just everything else. Damn, Jeff. Damn. That's it, man. It's what's up, dude? Every time there's dead silence, rock that alarm.
I was taking a drink, sorry.
I'm just kidding.
You know what's funny? You know where I found that alarm? There's a video on YouTube called Submarine Alarm, or 2 hours of a submarine alarm. So it's basically somebody put a video up of 2 hours of a submarine alarm just going off. But it had like 10,000 views. I'm like, what the hell?
People need that in their life.
I guess, man. It's like those weird ASMR videos right there. Somebody just sitting around listening to some submarine alarms. Yeah, YouTube's pretty handy, I noticed. Like when I was messing around with the animation and doing my you know, my intro and stuff. I got a lot of my sound effects off of YouTube there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How do you take sound effects off of YouTube?
Well, I mean, it's funny, but people post stuff like that. Uh-oh. The busted. God, I didn't have an alarm for Kevin Cross showing up. So say, Jeff, sorry, that's the mail. We'll contact you ASAP. It was either Kevin or somebody like pretending to be Kevin. I think it's really him.
I don't know, man. Now it's even more of a mystery.
Yeah. It looks like a thumbnail, but I don't know, man. Could be something else. I can't click out of here because you can change that thing too. But yeah, give me a call, man. Or not a call, but just, you know, come on the show sometime if you want. You're wondering what happened to you. Need to come back and lead the hundreds. The hundreds is a mess. Mike Emmerich is fucking picking over.
Oh.
Corey Kerr is like second in the command. Or no, it'd probably be Gaspar would be second in command. Going down the tubes, man. You gotta come back and lead it.
Alright.
Or no, maybe Marshall. Maybe Marshall took it over. I might forget. Right.
Don't lie, dude. We took it over. And we're dragging it down the tubes.
That could be. That could be. Oh, no. The fucking mess.
Right. Tell us how you really feel, Kevin.
Maybe it is Kevin. That's almost what you'd say. Showing the video I found. That what Frank said. Well, we thought maybe this was you. Do I have those images still? Right here. This is my theory. You probably watched the show of Salazar. Yeah, I figured you ran off with this hot mummy chick, and then you were hosting this horror show as Monkey Mod. See what I mean? Because look at the thumbnail right there. Where is the thumbnail? See? It's semi-close, except for sunglasses instead of that mask. And then plus you got all the buttons on your jacket and stuff. I bet you got a jacket like that. So, yeah. I'll stop. Oh. I feel very bad. What's next? Now Corey Kerr's going to come and start yelling at me.
It's bound to happen. It's bound to happen.
Or Josh is going to come and yell at me for playing his video where he's like singing from the grave.
What's your favorite shot or what?
I did like that part of that video. That's awesome. Don't you think?
Hell yeah.
That was awesome. Silent.
There it is. Kevin. Come on, man. Pound the fucking alarm.
Kevin. Well, I don't have a Kevin. I know. I made a deal. Unless we have Whisper Network news.
Wow. Yeah. Don't make me go to Twitter and create Whisper Network news.
But that one guy did put two names on there.
He did.
He said Gail
Simone.
It could be, Kevin. I do have a jacket like that. But the image isn't up to my quality. Yeah, that's kind of true. That's true. He probably, like, you know, retro it out or something. I was actually over there watching videos of Kevin's, and I was laughing at a lot of them that I kind of had forgotten. Like, you remember, like, the one where he's, like, driving through town, and he kind of does, like, this retro... I don't know how to describe it, like a cop kind of thing, or not like a cop, like a Mickey Spillane kind of spiel. Like, you know, heading into the dark city. You know, blah, blah, blah. You remember that one?
Mm-hmm.
It was funny. And then he did it all with, like, you know, he changed the footage to black and white. Like it was an old Mickey Spillane movie or whatever, my camera. Let's see. Have CB pop in and give the updates. Yeah, I know. Where is CB right now?
Right.
He says, I'll have CB pop in and give the updates about the Whisper Networks. And I said, where is CB right now?
Yeah, man. He should be in there so he can.
Yeah.
Make a little, you can make a little clip every time he comes in, like, dee 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 on the Whisper Network.
Yeah. But anyway, there was the two names on there who I didn't really, I know the one, Gail Simone, that's like Ethan MacGyver's like arch enemy for some reason. And then, but I didn't know the other one.
Yeah, I didn't either.
Yeah, so they're probably part of it. I'm sure all women are. They're probably every chick, as soon as they get into comics, gets a pass into that place. Just for being a chick, don't you think?
Well, I'm just going to say, yeah.
Yeah. I do love the old pulps. I think it is Kevin. It's a real favorite. That's great, Rhett. I mean, I miss your videos. I wish you'd come back to it for YouTube. That'd be awesome. Or actually just come on the show as well. I hang out with this kid. So.
Come make this show classy.
That's right. Just like the old Arcast. Back before we wrecked it with Scott. No, I didn't say that, did I?
Well, I'm working on it, man. I'm trying. I'm trying over here.
No, I'm wrecking it with Jim. That's right.
That's right. I'm trying to lower the bar, people.
Oh. You know the only reason I'm getting on here tonight, Jim. Was it to you? I didn't know you were waiting. I'd just be like, yeah, on the bed. Let's see. I'm curious about what the video you found is all about. Well, no, it wasn't a video. It was just these pictures. So, right? Or was there a video, Jim? Oh, I like come on that. Okay. Not drawing tonight, though. All right. That's cool. Let me send it away. How do I send it to you, though? If I throw it in the chat, will nobody else come in? It's like, I don't think you're on Facebook anymore, right, dude? I mean, I guess I could email it to you. I don't know if that's a pain. And this wasn't as hard as I thought it was going to be. Finding Kevin Cross was pretty much a process. I thought we were going to be able to ride that bus till the end of the, 100 days or whatever.
Well, you can shut down that GoFundMe for the PI.
I sent it to your email. So it should be in there. Because Kevin hates Facebook too. A lot of people hate Facebook. You get a lot of grief about Facebook because they're the scum of the earth. They're like worse than, what was the other one? The Chinese TikTok or whatever?
TikTok, man.
Yeah. That's the American version. So.
There it is. They're stealing your soul. Selling it to China is what I heard.
Though I gotta admit, though, I don't see like how, why is that site popular though? I mean, I was like on it for, 30 minutes, and I just couldn't take it, man. I had to get the hell out of there.
That TikTok?
Yeah, that TikTok site was brutal.
You could tell something was fishy, dude. That's what it was. Something's wrong here, man.
Just the interface. I don't know what it was, but it's just like as you go through the videos, it seems like there's like no place just to kind of go in there and sit and like look for stuff. Like on YouTube, you know how you can like search something and then you see the thumbnails and you kind of browse. But on that side, it's just like you're instantly in videos. So it's like channel surfing through everybody's like comedy routine or dance video, You're just like, stop. It's crazy.
Frank, we found Kevin.
Okay, give me a couple seconds.
Cool.
Let's see. Salazar, we found Kevin. The submission is done. Now we take down the Whisper Network. Oh, man. I don't think we can actually.
I don't know, man.
There's no taking them down, you think, Jerry?
I don't know.
That's like impossible.
That's like taking down the government.
They're everywhere, dude. Impossible.
That ain't gonna happen.
Yeah, that is not gonna happen. It's like one of those losing fights where you're just like trying to stay alive as long as you can, like Tetris or something. Let's see, somebody messing with something.
Oh.
Oh, Frank. What are you sending me, Frank?
Uh-oh. Porn. Frank's sending some porn over.
Oh, no. Is this what I think it is?
Uh-oh.
Oh, no. Hang on. I think I do. Hold on. Closing windows. I'm going to close the screen. Screen back. Where is Streamer? Did I close it? Are you still there, Jimmy?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. Because I opened my email, that's what's messing me up. All
right. Wake up, people. Good morning.
So I know that he did that just so that he could hear the alarm again. So anyway, look at this. Oh, wow. Are they watching the show right now? What? There's like more children. Like, I can't, I should have saved this to my thing because I can't zoom it. I'll just read it. So Margaret Owen, socially distant, blah, 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 says, if this is a Hydra level organization, formal petition to make the code identifying phrase Hailgate. And then Valkyrie says, what? Question mark, explanation point, a whole bunch of stuff. People of a different demographic than me are consuming media differently than me and discussing it in private. This will not stand. Oh, what a burn.
There it is.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, bitch. All right.
Damn. Hydra News.
Wow, I better not. Yeah, maybe we should stop talking about them. That kind of hurt a little bit.
Right, I got you.
Yeah, they'll be a new thing.
All right, I'm going to get you by the balls.
Those chicks, yeah. All chicks already have you by the balls. Unfortunately, except for fat chicks.
There you go, and now you know, people.
Weren't you here? That's the Whisper Network alarm there, Kevin. I figured you said, give me a minute, you were like stepping away. The Hydra News. Good morning, folks. See, we're getting canceled by the Whisper Network, which is like
the chick
network, that the secret chick network that's out to cancel basically all comics, take over the whole comics industry. So so we got an alarm now for when we got a scramble.
There you go. Yeah, so you know to get under your desk and hide,
or when Frank's got a scramble.
There it is. Real life superhero.
That's right.
So we should hit the art cast real quick, huh?
Right now?
I don't know. Okay, we can wait. Just 42 in.
I guess we could. All right. Let's see. Get rid of this. It's like where are they having this discussion about us, though? It's like, I don't understand, like, where people see it. Like, I just don't understand Twitter. I'm much of an idiot, you know? Or yeah. Are we, like, all blocked on there so you can't see what they're saying?
I don't think I've ever even posted one thing on Twitter. I think I have an account, nothing up.
Well, I've been posting the new videos on Twitter.
Mm.
But you know what the thumbnail for this one's going to be.
Well, I wonder.
Yeah.
All right. That's just that Hydra level whisper network alert.
Yeah. All right. The main man is here, so we're going to push the Arcasters thing back for a while.
All right.
Oh, it is. It's Kevin Cross.
What's up, puckers?
Back on YouTube. Good. See? How about you, dude?
Yeah, it's me. So what's going on? What's happening?
Well, we're just drawing comics and doing the 100 days again. So we.
I like to hear that.
Notice that you've been gone for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have. I've been a little disillusioned with everything that's been going on, not just comics, but the world.
Yeah.
And yeah. So yeah, I stepped away. I haven't been paying attention to YouTube. I've been paying attention to social media. I got off Facebook. I'm about to delete Twitter. Yesterday, or was it maybe it was earlier today, I decided, I was like, oh, I'm gonna check out some shit on YouTube, and I saw your thumbnail came up and I was like, what the fuck's going on?
Yeah,
I can cuss here, right?
Yeah, you can totally
I'm also this is what? Full of vodka, so I'm a little drunk. That's why I'm not drinking tonight.
We encourage it. So, well, yeah. Cool. I mean, it's just the rumors abound. So we just.
What are the rumors? Like, well, like what is that?
Well, whatever we can come up with.
What is that? Like, okay, maybe I should hang up now, because I love conspiracy theories, and if it can get people to my Patreon or something,
yeah,
more the better. But yeah. So tell me what's been happening.
Well, I mean, you know, since you disappeared or whatever, I guess it's sort of my doing, but it's like, I just started wondering, like, what happened to Kevin? What happened to Kevin? And then, I don't know. It's just, we just started coming up with theories of, like, what happened.
So the
latest one was you were in the monkey suit with that chick. That was one of them. And then the other ones were, you had become like, I mean, the real life superhero thing came up one day with these crazy guys that dress up like superheroes. So we thought maybe you had donned the Monkey Mutt outfit and was down there like at the autonomous zone kicking ass or something.
This might surprise you, because behind the scenes, like way back when, and I do miss talking to you, Jeff.
So,
this might surprise you. And it's not far off base. I do live in Portland. There's riots all over the fucking goddamn place.
Yeah, man.
And I've been typically considered a liberal, you know. Right before all this shit popped off, I did apply to be a cop in town.
Really?
Yep.
Oh my God.
Yep. And what? And I was going through the process, and then all of a sudden this defund police shit happened, and now I don't know.
Oh, so you actually applied before all this whole Black Lives
I did right crazy. Before it happened. I applied
three
weeks before, and I was going through the process as a candidate to be a police officer, and my thing was, like, better someone like me than maybe the people that all the rioters hate.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what I've been doing.
That's crazy. I never would have thought that for sure. Didn't put your Patreon.
Nobody would have. Like, in the like, chat, Yeah, old punk dude who hates authority.
Yeah, man.
My deal with that was, instead of complaining about it, do something about it.
Do something about it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I applied to be a cop, and apparently I'm still an applicant, or I'm still a candidate. And now it's a little scary.
Yeah.
So I might still do it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so conspiracy theories, whatever. I dropped out of art and comics for a minute to maybe be a cop.
Yeah. Different, remember when I was saying, like, whatever it was, it's going to be weirder than than what we were thinking of.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely weirder than
what we were thinking. Yeah, you got me.
Sorry, I couldn't hear that. You guys are kind of breaking up a little bit.
Oh, sorry. Well, I just said the truth is weirder than what we were thinking up on our own.
Well, tell me what you're thinking up, because I saw the video and I had my daughter today and girlfriend stuff, and I was like, you know, I was gonna try to find the 2 hours to listen to that live stream,
yeah,
and then I just happened to check in on you tonight. And I was like, oh, shit.
You know? We're live and talking about you again.
Yeah.
Well, that was like, I mean, that was like, I don't remember what the beginning was of like the whole Kevin Cross thing, but that was where it was ending up, was the real life superhero thing. And then the pictures of that ape guy that does the horror show.
Yeah.
I mean, what's your girlfriend look like? She doesn't dress up like a mummy, does she?
No, she doesn't. But not far off. She's a little goth.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm an old punk guy, so you know, I like the goth girls, you know.
Right.
She's sleeping over there.
Oh wow, cool. So, you traded up, got rid of the old hagger wife and got yourself a new cool one.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. So what's going on about the comic though, man? I mean, it's like everybody's okay. Just on pins and needles waiting for this this masterpiece, man. And
okay. Me too. Hashtag me too. So sorry buddy, don't cancel me. Still liberal.
The Whisper Network's after us too, so we got a whole bunch of
Dude, I'm still a liberal. However, all the cancel culture, all that shit, it's not what I signed on for.
Yeah.
You know? I've been told in town I'm a classical liberal now.
Mm.
Which anyway, whatever. Politics, yeah. Fuck off.
Yeah.
So what's going on with Muckymon now is because of cancel culture and things like that, people who claim to be anti-racist or have said that I'm being racist because I'm using a monkey as a hero. And so it's That's driving great. Me fucking crazy. I know, of course you love it because we like back when we could talk about this stuff as you being more conservative and me being more liberal, we could be friends, and we're still friends. We can talk about that stuff and have a discourse, and that's why I'm like, yes, I'm still a fuck, like a liberal,
yeah. But
like what's going on right now is like it's driving me bananas. Yeah. No pun intended.
And I am racist against monkeys, so that's great.
Whoa. That's gonna be on Twitter in about 5 minutes, Jeff.
Yeah. You know, I realize coming on here and I'm canceling myself.
You know, that's so true though. Like when we used to do the show like all the time, we used to talk about the shit like all the time, and then you know.
Yeah, I mean we don't
nobody gave a shit, you know.
Yeah, we don't like eye to eye politically.
Yeah.
But we do enough to be able to have like a conversation and still be friends and what's going on right now in my town is you have to toe the party line exactly.
Yeah.
And I'm like, look, fuckers, I'm an American. I might be like a left American and you just want communism or Marxism. Fuck off.
Yeah.
You know? And you know, it drives me fucking bonkers.
Yeah, it's crazy. And I can see, you know, you leave on Facebook and stuff because it's like that's where it all is. You know?
Yeah, and that's why I'm leaving. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stay on Instagram.
Yeah.
And I'm going to stop posting like personal stuff with me skateboarding with my daughter.
Oh, cool.
There's a lot of that on there now. There's so much that it's going to take me a while to like go through and delete things.
Yeah.
But it's just going to be an art channel and it's not going to be political. It's just going to be whatever I create, you know, yeah. At this point. So I've kind of taken a step back from the internet, from YouTube, from all that kind of stuff. To kind of clean house.
Yeah.
So going to Monkey Mod, it's still something I want to do, but there's a storyline I wanted to do for Monkey Mod.
Yeah.
That feels more important right now to me.
Yeah.
And so on Patreon right now, I'm building this story from the ground up because apparently I have to rewrite a ton of Monkey Mod stuff.
Well, that's great, man. So you're still working, doing comics, which that's like the main
thing. I am. I'm just not doing it publicly.
Yeah.
I almost kind of am bored with Monkey Mod at this point.
Yeah.
Because I've gotten so much heck about it, you know?
Yeah.
It was supposed to be kind of a fun spy romp.
Yeah.
And people are politicizing it because there's animals representative of emotions and character types and things like that. My original idea with doing that was not to be like some furry or something. Yeah. It was more because I didn't, you know, as someone who's from San Francisco and Berkeley and Portland and Oakland and shit like that, I didn't want to have to deal with certain people thinking it was representative of human races. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I'm getting that now. And so I'm like, oh fuck. I just wanted to be like the owl is wise.
Yeah.
You know, the elephant is strong and steadfast. The rhino's a brute. You know, like old ancient tropes in storytelling. Right. And then I wanted to do it like kind of Hanna-Barbera 1970s, like a ridiculous adventure. And that has been politicized.
I know, so, isn't that crazy, man? That's nuts.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, and it's so crazy right now. Things are so crazy right now. Like, again, liberal Jude wanting to get canceled from liberal people.
Yeah,
you know, because fuck, you know. Sorry to cuss so much.
It's all right. The fuck quota has gone up today.
I mean, tell you what. If you want to find me, how good is it to find me to be in an inebriated state?
Absolutely.
Perfect,
bro.
Yeah, perfect for the show.
Yeah. So.
Well, I think it's great that you're still doing comics and stuff. You're hanging in there, getting stuff done. And
that's
kind of what I hope. Because, you know, I realized you pulled back, and I imagined it was probably something like that because, you know, YouTube, it's pressure, you know. Sometimes there it's pressure, sometimes it's bad, but you know, it's pressure. So
yeah, totally. And you know, there's a, in the last like year, it came to a point where, you know, when I got married, I thought this is for life. I got my wife and we got our daughter and stuff like that. Now I find myself single and dating strippers and shit like that. And so
God bless America.
Man, I wish I had the stripper alarm on this show.
Bless America. And so, you know, I'm being kind of facetious, but also kind of true, but, you know, I found myself in like a position I didn't think I was in, and it, because of what happened in my life, it made the comic fall back quite a bit, which kind of sucks because I've been accused of like, oh, why didn't I come out? And I was like, because I was in divorce court, fucker.
Yeah, you know,
and now we find ourselves in a place where we got COVID-19, we've got cancel culture, we've got riots in the streets, and I'll tell you, protest, fantastic.
Yeah,
but you know, don't tell me you're liberal and on the same side as me and then cancel me later because I don't agree with you stealing and looting.
Yeah.
I think that's bullshit, you know?
Yeah.
So I find myself in a weird spot. I'm also moving. That's why there's all this disarray behind me.
Cool. Or I guess cool. I don't know.
So you know, I've been finding myself in a weird spot.
Yeah.
And then being accused of Monkey Mod being something that originally I want to be like a fun kind of romp. And now it's politicized with some people. And it's like, oh, fuck. You know?
Yeah.
And so I've got like the divorce and things that have slowed it down.
Sure,
and it's pretty much, the first issue's done.
Yeah.
But now I'm like, do I put it out?
Right.
Well,
I mean, I don't, you know, I don't want to like be saying like, you know, anything like that. You know, I didn't want to pressure you or anything like that. I think it's just what people think of you when they think of you. They think of like Monkey Wad now, like they think of me with the Berserker on. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but totally.
I think it's just like, you know, it's like, I mean, it's what you're doing. I mean, you're an artist, and plus you're an indie artist. And that's like what we all do. We all get off on these tangents, you know, just like me doing stop motion and shit, but you just got to fucking go and scratch. So I say, hell yeah, go fucking scratch it, you know?
Yeah. So I worry about that because I did this big thing. I guess it would be like last year.
Yeah.
Where I was like, hey, you know, if you donate a certain, you know, on my Patreon, you donate $5. You get the comic for free, the print version, you get the digital version.
Yeah.
And life changed. And then, and I'm not as interested in the story, you know?
Yeah.
Luckily, I don't have that many followers. <You know? laughs> So I haven't gotten a lot of pushback.
Yeah.
I feel like they might get the new comic, which is kind of more personal, which I think will be good. Of course, like Monkey Mon, it's going to be ridiculous.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think it might be better. I don't know.
I think that's cool. And I also think Patreon's a really tough one to figure out. It's so hard to like, because I've done that same thing where I've given stuff away, you know, pretty well for a few years, and then, you know, just get to the point where you're like, wow, you know, so much effort for like 8 people or something, you know. And
so, yeah, I also kind of realized with Patreon, I was delivering like really hard on a couple of tiers for like 1 or 2 people, and it was taking me longer to do that than to actually do what people were coming to me for in Patreon.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And you know, I just came to accept, like, my Patreons are patrons are willing to go $5 maximum.
Yeah.
And there was a couple people, and, you know, God bless them, who went above and beyond. But I was spending more time for those two people than, like, the 20 people on the $5 and the, you know, 40 people on the $1.
Yeah.
So starting in August, I'm doing one tier. That's it.
Yeah.
Which you did. You did a long time ago.
Yeah.
I
don't know if I'm a good example, though. My Patreon has slowly died over, like, the last 3 years. You know?
Oh, man. I've been hearing that from so many people.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Aren't we all?
It might just be that site or something. I don't know. But I don't know.
It could be, like, you know, it's the times. I don't know. You know.
Me too. Yeah.
But
I think that's a cool thing, though. You know, simplify it up so that you can just take care of business on there and get on to other stuff. So.
Yeah, I think so, because I mean, when Patreon first started, it was to support the creators that you like.
Yeah.
So they can keep doing what they're doing. They don't have to work at Walmart. They don't have to go work at 7-Eleven. They don't have to drive for Postmates or shit like that, which I've been doing. But a lot of creators, I mean, things change, you know, it's been a lot of years and things kind of change where, there's a lot of creators, they're like, I'm going to send you this thing every month. I'm going to do this thing every month. And so now I think that has kind of set up things where Patreons expect to get a product every month, where there's like a button or a print or something like that. And people who aren't creators don't quite understand that is taking away from the creation of the thing that you showed up in the first place for.
Yeah, absolutely. Eventually you start, like, working just for Patreon.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I found myself kind of doing that for a little bit with Monkey Mod, is I found myself working for Patreon, for patrons, and then I wasn't getting anything done with the fucking comic. You know, I was at that point, I was doing like a page a month.
Yeah.
Where beforehand I was doing 5 pages a month, you know?
Yeah.
And then I was being asked, like, where is this? Where is this fucking thing I signed up for? And I was like, but you also want all this other stuff. I still have to survive, and my Patreon is not paying my rent or my mortgage, and, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's one of those tough, and especially, like, I think, like, us, you know, we're at a level, which I know yours is probably more than mine now, but it's like, you know, it's not one of those, you know, we're not making like a $2,000 a month on there. You're just making, you know, a few hundred bucks, and then it's just like, it's a ton of work just for that few hundred bucks, you know? And so, like, if you put too much effort into it, it just, like, overtakes, like, you know, the thing you're trying to get going. So, man, you know, what can you do?
Yeah. It's rough because, you know, like, we're doing some stuff we really believe in, and now we have the platform, you know, and we're also up against people who say it's grifting and begging. And yet we're working really fucking hard. And then we're still not making a living off of the thing, which I know a lot of Patreon people do. But not everyone can. And we're probably in that camp of not everyone can, you know?
Yeah.
And then we want to deliver, but we can't because we have children. We have any number of things going on in our lives. And then people get mad.
Yeah.
Because they don't quite understand or I mean, I'm not trying to be a dick, you know, but it's like maybe they don't I think it's fine to say they don't quite understand what we're doing, you know.
Yeah, yeah. No, I agree. And I think a lot of times, like, those people that you know, complain and call us grifters and stuff. I mean, what I notice, a lot of that comes from, like, other artists, you know. It's like other artists that are sort of struggling with their own work, you know.
Yeah.
And there's always that thing that's happening with artists where, like, one looks at another and, you know, oh, well, he's got three more things than I got, so, like, I don't like him. And this guy's got, you know, six more things than I got. And that's always seems to be where the grifter comments and all that kind of stuff. But you rarely get that from the people who actually like your work, you know.
Yeah, that's something too. Like, you know, when I first started, like, YouTube and stuff like that, I was like, one of my goals with 100 Days of Making Comics was not just to, hey, you should do exactly 100 Days of Making Comics. The point of it was to be like, hey, we're artists, you know, we're up against clients who are taking advantage of our skills, and sometimes we have to take those jobs because we got to pay rent, knowing full well that these people who might have gotten a trust fund to start a wealthy business don't get that, you know. It was, I was trying to empower people, you know.
Yeah.
To kind of take back a little bit of their artistic power, you know, to not just, like, to be an artist. If you like comics, you don't have to work for DC and Marvel. You don't even have to do Image or Dark Horse, you know. And some people took it that way, and some people took it the opposite of what I meant.
Took it over, I mean, when you started it, I mean, that was the thing. Because I remember, you know, you were working, like, I don't know how many hours, you know, 10 hours a day on that graphic novel.
Tons.
And then you had no time to draw. And so this was like your one little, you know, that's what the 30 minute thing came from. It's like, this is my one little fucking sliver that I'm going to, like, take back from all these fucking assholes that have, you know what I mean, their hand in your pocket, whether it's, like, people reaching there for rent or, like, the people you're working for and all that kind of stuff. It's like, this is my one little bit, you know? And that's cool about
it. Totally. And I think that was a misconception too, is because I was, at that point when I started it, I was a new father. I was married back then. And that was the time I could allot. You know what I'm saying? It's like, if I could have done more, I would have, but I was doing that graphic novel. I was working on a kid's book for Scholastic at the point. I had this kid's book agent. I don't know. I couldn't think of that word. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Because booze. So I was like 30 minutes. And then it became this like dogmatic doctrine of 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And then here comes all these people who are kind of lazy about it.
Yeah.
And my point was, and I probably wasn't clear enough, because I started the thing by myself, not thinking anyone was going to grab onto it, you know. Yeah. And it became like a thing, which is cool. And I'm not trying to diss anyone who, you know, grabbed onto it, but it became 30 minutes and it became a hardline 30 minutes. My point was, you do it in the time that you have. And to make it not like, well, you know, I have 15 minutes. So I can just do that. It had to be a little bit challenging. Like, I'm tired right now. I'm going to go say, if you're one of those people who grabbed onto the doctrine, which was not my point of 30 minutes, but you had an hour, you got to do an hour. You know, yeah. If 30 minutes was comfortable, but an hour, you're a little bit tired, you're just kind of pushing it before you could do what you could do with like your day job or your family or things like that. And you know, one of the things that I think turned into a shit show is people were just like 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And I was like, really? You're 22, like I'm being kind of a dick here, but I would see somebody, I'm like, you're 22 years old. You live at home 30 minutes. You should do fucking 4 to 6 hours. You fucking loser. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm being a little pedantic or
you're getting the truth here, people. You're getting the truth.
And that is one of the reasons why, you know, a couple, 2-3 years ago with, cause I did want to be, cause when I started 100 Days of Making Comics, I thought it was going to be very small. I didn't think at all that this many people, I thought maybe like one or two of my friends might jump aboard, you know?
Yeah.
And it became way bigger, and then it just turned into something I did not want it to be. And that is another reason why I stepped away from social media and to be the guy who started it and shit. Because really, if you're watching the show, it's like, fuck you. Do the work when you can do it. Pay attention to what you can do, you know, in your daily life that you have to do to survive and live. But the point was, you're not living the life you want. You want to do something more, do that. Don't just follow what I did. And so maybe that's my fault, but that's wasn't my intention. You know, at the time I could do 30 minutes because I was working so goddamn much and I was the primary parent for my daughter when I was married. And you know, I'm not a religious dude. It was not the constitution of 100 Days of Making Comics. It was not the
Ten Commandments.
It was not the Ten Commandments. You know, I often think, and maybe this is a fault, that artists were smarter than a lot of other people because we have to think abstractly a lot of times. And so I thought maybe people who were grasping onto it would kind of take the principle of the thing and apply it to their personal lives, not take it and apply it to my life at the time and my life now. And then it became something on Facebook where it became some committee that I wasn't even kind of part of.
Hmm.
And so I don't know. I'm going on a rant. I'm probably going to pour myself another drink.
Perfect.
You know, Kevin, though, I tell you what, you know, I mean, even though I think it kind of went off the rails at times and, you know, like you said, you know, the 30 minute a day thing kind of like caught on like fire and everybody was doing that kind of stuff. I think the one thing where you really did help a lot of people, though, is you had the guys who were like good artists and, you know, they were like trapped in their own like head. You know what I mean? They like set up so many like roadblocks of like perfection and all those kinds of things.
Well, and that, you know what I mean? Great, because that's where I was, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, you had a lot of work too, but I'm talking about those guys who totally have the opportunity to do their comic and all that kind of stuff, but just can't get by themselves to actually draw their comic. And I think that's one thing where you still helped a lot of people, when you busted some of those guys out of that problem, you know, where it's like, hey, I actually, even 30 minutes a day got me drawing and eventually got my comic out. So, you know what I mean?
That makes me feel good because that was kind of the point, you know? Yeah. I found myself, as you know, working for these publishers, who demanded a lot of shit and things I didn't quite agree with or enjoy doing or, you know, whatever the case was.
And they have their fingers all up in your project, messing them up. That's what you're saying. Just like all these dumbass art directors.
Yeah, totally. And so the, the point was, yes, we have to make money. We have to, you know, we live in a capitalist society where we have to make money. We have to pay rent. We have to pay the mortgage. We have to pay for our kids, things like that. Yes, and that is important. But if you're only living for that, how's life going for you? It sucks, you know? My point was to make, essentially, as artists, to not work for other people and to just chisel out a little bit of time for yourself to make your own thing with your own voice, with however much time you have. Everyone's different, like I said. And it became these rules, you know?
Yeah.
And then people jumped on board, and because I was so soft, they kind of made it a thing.
Yeah. Where, I mean, it took on a life of its own, dude. You know what I mean?
It
wasn't nothing you really did. You know, you took care of your own business, but I mean, it just took on a life of its own. Now I see people doing it and they don't even like mention that, you know, you were the creator or anything. It's kind of almost, it's, I don't know, developed into its own entity, and it's just out there running wild now, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. And you know, it, at one point, you know, I kind of think like Inktober is associated with Jake Parker.
Yeah.
And but you know, he's not making money off of people doing Inktober.
Yeah.
And it's not like I'm looking for accolades or anything. Because that wasn't my point. I wasn't trying to be der Führer of some kind of like scene or something, you know? I just kind of wanted to present something and say, hey, you know, we can do our own thing better. And now we got Jake Parker. He does Inktober. And you know, I follow a lot of artists on Instagram. And they do Inktober, and you know, they sell their originals, and you know,
yeah,
that's fucking great. That's kind of what I wanted it to be. I just wanted it to be kind of an empowering thing for artists to do their own thing. I mean, there was kind of like a little bit of me wanted to like bring tear down Marvel and DC and.
Yeah.
You know, these like 75-year-old characters and have some fresh blood in something that I care about, you know?
Yeah.
But it became this thing that I don't love. And I still trying to figure out why a little bit, you know? I think there was a couple opportunists, not naming any names, in the midst.
Okay.
Like originally I had a Facebook group and I wanted it to be like a community conversation, you know, help each other out, that kind of stuff. And then it kind of became like a product, and sometimes I wasn't quite invited for, and I'm not quite sure why it was different than Inktober in that. So, and you know, maybe I'm to blame for that, but I need to understand that too a little bit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't worry about it. I think that you helped way more people than you. I mean, I don't think you hurt anybody. I think everybody who's done it, so, you know, whether they made it or not, you know, succeeded or failed, I think they got something out of it, you know, that they can use. So I think in general, it was a good thing for sure. I tell you though, it's like there, I still have this one thing with you though, Kevin, that I still hold to. And you probably, I remember you used to get annoyed when I say it back then, but I'm going to throw it out again.
Are we going to fight right now? Are we about to fight?
Fight. I've always been like, out of all of us, you know, that should run a Kickstarter. You know what I mean? I've always been like, fucking Kevin's the one who could bring home the bucks. And beyond that, now I'm like, screw Kickstarter. Indiegogo is where all the money is.
Is
like, I want to see you run an Indiegogo now, dude. Because
okay,
like,
okay. Sorry. Finish your thought. Okay. Sorry,
because I was gonna wrap it up. I said, you are the guy who started the 100 Days of Comics, and you're the only one that can make that claim. So I mean, I just think, you know, it's just the perfect storm, man.
Okay, so let me ask you this. Why Indiegogo over Kickstarter?
Oh, I don't know. Just because there's been so many, and I know a lot of more Comicsgate projects, but it's like because there's been so many big comics projects over there, you know,
in demand.
Some, yeah, yeah. So
part of it, you know, I did. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, sorry. I'm interrupting.
It's all right. Just I was going to say the in demand part of it too, where you can keep the thing in the store open and just kind of keep selling. It's just really cool, but.
So going back to a little bit of the political stuff that we were talking about earlier, because
sure.
You know, I don't want to be super political. I followed the Comicgate stuff, and some of the people who were involved I disagreed with politically, and some of the people I was like, well, I'm the brand of liberal who's like, I'm going to fight for you to get your message out if there's a message.
Yeah.
Regardless, because I believe in freedom of speech, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that, you know, I saw they are all going to Indiegogo, but I haven't paid attention to it for what, like 2 years? I think that was like 2 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
So I'm asking you not as like a gotcha thing. I'm asking you as actually a ignorant about the
thing. Okay. You know, well, Kickstarter is still a thing for sure, but
right.
I mean, there's just a lot of like big projects on Indiegogo, and I mean the other thing is just the in demand, which I like that better. But you know, you are like a rebel, and like you know, I mean, love the Comicsgate guys, hate them, whatever. I mean, and they're not, you know, Comicsgate is so splintered. There's almost no Comicsgate anymore. You know, it's kind of like.
Here's the thing. It's like yeah. Everything is so. Everyone wants to make things so black and white nowadays with like the COVID and civil unrest and stuff like that. And it's not. Everything's fucking gray.
Absolutely.
Amen.
And so, like, I'm a little disillusioned with the political party that I was that I've you know I'm registered with but I'm still aligned with the ideals that why I joined that political party. But at the end of the day, I live in a Western society. I believe in freedom, liberty, freedom of speech, discourse, peaceful protest, things like that, you know? So I'm making this political after I just said I don't want to be political.
Didn't it's I? All right. I can't remember one show you're ever on, Kevin, that we didn't have to go to politics or religion. So that's not a big deal.
Well, I mean, yeah, but here's another thing, too, is like a lot of times, like we were doing the original R-casters, we save that stuff for just me and you talking afterwards, you know, and we would draw for like 3 or 4 hours afterwards and just talk about shit and not be like, I got to cancel you because you don't agree with me. And, you know, we just talk about it and we'd still remain friends, you know, and it's, I don't like that our society has gone to a place where we can't do that.
I know. Isn't it weird?
And it happens so fast.
Yeah. You
know? It's And so anyway.
No,
I know that Comicsgate was really Indiegogo, and being on Twitter, there was a lot of cancel culture, early cancel culture stuff about, you know, that's this right wing, you know, everything's a Nazi if you don't believe in a certain thing. And, sure. and no, they're not fucking Nazis. And me being on the same, like, or maybe registered as the same political party, I'm like, they're not fucking Nazis.
Right. They
have a little bit different opinion, and fuck, you know, it's really disappointing and annoying.
And so
there's a reason why I'm about to get real political. I think there's a reason why in this country that we have different political parties. It's because I think it's necessary for discussion. And to just say that someone is a fucking Nazi, I mean, read a fucking history book before you say that. Listen, but anyway, so Indiegogo was the like right wing Kickstarter, right? And I was like, well, some of those people might be politically right wing, but I was paying attention to it, and they were saying, we're, you know, I might be a Republican, and so me, I'm registered Democrat for now. And they were saying, but this comic is not political. So, but they were still kind of early cancel culture being like called these Nazis. And I was like, no, because they're not racist. They're not trying to start concentration camps. They're not, you know, I'm like, so, but there was a minute there where Indiegogo was the right wing. You know,
yeah.
So that's why I'm asking my questions about.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was more, you know, in the early days of like Comicsgate, like when, you know, it was like Richard Meyer and Ethan Van Sciver, Mike Miller, all those guys, you know, because like Indiegogo, like as you know, was like kind of nothing before that. I mean, you'd never take a comic book project to Indiegogo. That'd be die, you know. And anyway, with some of those early guys that came on, you know, were hardcore Comicsgate, also hardcore conservative. But, you know, like you said, it's been 2 years. And so a lot of comics guys have just gravitated towards Indiegogo. And so, like, now, I mean, I don't know if it is still looked at like the conservative hub or the right-wing hub. I mean, that's why I initially went there, because I was like, wow, look at all this money. I'm going to jump in on this. I didn't give a shit. Conservative, what, you know me, Republican, Democrat, I don't fucking care, you know.
I know we've talked about this extensively, like off air, you know.
And so, you know, like I went because of the money, you know. I didn't end up making a ton there, but I made my amount, you know.
Oh well, you know Republicans care more about money than making your
that's right.
I'm a fucking Democrat who is a capitalist. I want to make money too.
Absolutely, that's what everybody does. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
And but that's kind of my point, is like I don't know if that's still like the dogma. I mean, there's still a big fight between like whoever Comicsgate is fighting with, but like I said, it's splintered into so many different things. I just feel like comics or Indiegogo now is sort of like where comics go, you know. And even though there are still Kickstarter comics going and they work, I don't know. I really like Indiegogo after having done one over there, and I've done two Kickstarters. I like Indiegogo way better. Just
so
it's set up. So
let me ask you this. You're saying earlier that Indiegogo is more of an ongoing thing, where like, you know, Kickstarter is more of a like, I've got this project, one and done, you get the thing.
Yeah,
you know, you get the end product. So Indiegogo, you can keep it going.
Yeah, it's actually exactly the same as Kickstarter, where you run a campaign and you try to hit a goal. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you don't make it, you don't get the money. If you do, you get the money. But the one thing that Indiegogo has is this thing called in demand. And so like once you run a successful campaign, you can't do it unless you're successful.
Okay.
Then you can leave the Indiegogo up and people can just go there and like buy the product. And I think there's something like you have to ship within 6 months or something, but you know, I shipped like really quick after I did mine, so it was no big deal. Mm-hmm. But you know, like mine is actually still up and it's been like a year or so, and people still can go buy the book there. And it's really neat, because everybody who buys the book over these last couple of years, which I've made like another like 4,000 bucks over the last few years, it kind of goes into the, you know, I mean, their emails go into the same thing. So it's like the next time you run another one, you know, it goes out to all those people again. So that's what I really like about it, you know.
Mm.
So,
yeah. You heard that right, people. You can still buy the book on in demand on Indiegogo right now. $4 plus shipping. Or you can get it get a sketch and an autograph for 35. Go get it.
There you go.
Oh, yeah. I remember when you ran that first one, I had no money, but right now I do. So listen, everybody. I actually have an original piece of art. Original piece of art from the comic.
I remember your mom, though, backed it. Remember that?
I do remember because I was so fucking poor.
Yeah.
And I, my mom's pretty rad.
Yeah.
She likes the underdog. She likes to support the arts and stuff like that. And I was like, and I remember, I think it was the art book. And she goes, and
oh, I was like, was the art book. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was the art book. And I was like, my friend's doing an art book. I feel really bad. We talk all the time. Because at that point we were doing R-casters almost every day, maybe, you know, barring the weekends or something. But and she goes, well, okay, well, I'll do it for you. I still don't have the art book. My mom has it. so apparently she really likes it.
That was really cool of her to do that.
Yeah, my mom was my house was the one where, you know, I had the crazy hair and listening to, like, you know, Black Flag and shit like that. My mom was like, your friend should come over. And all my other friends were like, your friends are delinquents. So yeah, my mom's pretty cool. I get to be the one old 80s punk guy who didn't come from a broken home because of my mom. But anyway, so yeah, so maybe I'll look into Indiegogo because I'm still working on Monkey Mod, but I'm doing something a little different while I try to figure out what to do with Monkey Mod, because some of the story, not just oh shit, my girlfriend's calling in the other room. Been still trying to kind of figure out what to do with the story because it was originally written before I got divorced. Things have changed quite a bit, just not with only me but in society. And so the story I'm working on right now was supposed to be a Monkey Mod story. And it's kind of based on when I was divorced and had to move to Los Angeles for a while, be away from my daughter, even though I was the primary parent for her. And, you know,
yeah.
And I'm doing it in it's not a Mary Sue story, but it's based on that. And it's kind of a fantasy / dystopian / sci-fi kung fu story.
Cool.
But it was supposed to be Monkey Mod.
Yeah,
and I figure if I had originally planned to do this kind of 60s Hanna-Barbera, balls to the walls, goofy, silly story, and then bring it into this more personal story, and nowadays I'm just gonna write this as a separate story. I want to roll it out pretty quick with quality on Patreon. So I'm curious about this, about Indiegogo and stuff. And I'm also,
I think, you know, you got to write from like a place like that though, you know, like you said, Mary Sue, but I feel like, you know, like unless you're putting yourself into your story, like how you know what I mean? What kind of meaning is it going to have for anybody, unless
you're in this? Yeah.
So
like the only part of the story that's really could be considered Mary Sue is that it's a dude who thought he had this like loving family, who cared for his child, and then that all went away.
Yeah.
That's really the gist of the beginning, you know? And other than that, it's like, it is still stupid ridiculous, like Monkey Mod, where it's like barbarians who know kung fu and fight with sometimes a laser gun that they found.
Yeah.
You know? But
That sounds cool.
Yeah. So you know, I've put that out on Patreon right now. So far no one's really asked me about Monkey Mod.
Yeah.
Cause I'm kind of, that's kind of taking a back seat right now, especially with, what's going on in the world. Yeah.
And I feel like sometimes, cause I, with the Berserker Knot, I kind of went a little bit like that too, where it's like, you know, when do you kind of like pull the plug on something you don't feel like is working? You know?
Yeah, and that and that's hard because like so many people signed up for that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh man, I learned so many lessons from failing doing that I think I can actually deliver something great right now, but it worries me that you still want this thing that I'm not, my heart's not fully in it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Whereas the new story is more personal. And both like emotionally and with the ridiculous pop culture I like. It matches up, you know, it's one for one. So when I originally wrote Monkey Mon, I thought it was in a happy marriage, and it's the original script is just kind of there's not a lot of heart or emotion to it, other than the heart might come from the pop culture that I love, you know what I'm saying? But the story is just a romp.
Right.
And the new stuff that I want to do, it's a romp, but it's got a heart to it. It's got emotion to it, you know? Like there might be like a ridiculous thing where there's a kung fu fight out, but then there's going to be some kind of emotional thing where the character just about gets his kid back but doesn't, you know? So the stakes are higher, you know?
On the heartstrings a little more.
Yeah, totally. So I worry about that because, you know, initially you come to comics for fun, but you also come to stories to, I think for a little bit more than that. You know what I'm saying? If like a story is only just a fun romp, it's ultimately fun in the moment, but it's forgettable. If a story is just all drama and emotion, it might tug at your heartstrings at that point. But at the end of the day, it's it did that thing. It served its purpose. It's forgettable. What I want to do is a marriage of the two, where it's more like an experience, like a human experience. It's important. It feels bigger. I don't know if I'm explaining myself right, but
yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. I mean, all that stuff is crucial, I think, to like a good story, you know what I mean?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. I don't know. You gotta go for what you want to do, you know. I mean, that's one thing I think I had to learn about YouTube too, is at some point you just gotta turn off the audience, as bad as that sounds, you know. Everybody says listen to your audience, but I think you just gotta turn them down at some point and just be like, you know what I wanna do? This, and you just gotta fucking just plow ahead, you know.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, like, it's hard in today's day and age with the internet and Patreon and YouTube and, you know, thinking that we have to develop these supporters or a community or whatever the case might be. And I see it a lot. And I think I might have become kind of victim to this, my own fault. But might have become victim of this is you start catering to, this will get me more views, this will sell me more comics, you know, and at the end of the day, it's a detriment. It's just going to slap you in the face, you know, because I mean, I'm looking at my bookshelf right now and I see like, Robert E. Howard, H.P. Lovecraft, Ray Bradbury, mm-hmm. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, people like that. They didn't fucking have the internet.
Yeah.
You know, they created what they wanted to create, you know.
Yeah.
Whether it was like society at the time had a bearing on it, or they were making a comment on it, or they were making a fun romp, shit like that. And that stuff is classic, you know. And so I realized just saying that, I'm maybe being egotistical, saying I want to be a classic, dude. No, I just want to do a good thing, you know.
Yeah.
And I feel like right now, Monkey Mod, without giving away the old story, it doesn't work in today's society. I wrote it a few years ago, and the world has changed. And again, people are like, "Why is a monkey the hero?" And the original idea was because I think monkeys are cool.
Yeah,
because it's fun and cool. But right now, everything has to be politicized.
Yeah,
and so I have to put it down for now and just make that story that that's fun and
and
might mean something, you know. I mean, I'm not writing like 1984 or Animal Farm, but the new story does deal with fathers getting divorced and you know, ultimately, I think politically, whatever side you're on, most of us in the West want to do good.
Yeah.
We want to be good people. And it addresses some of that too, while being told, like, you're not, you know.
Yeah. So.
And does this story have a name?
It's called Disposable.
Hmm. You know,
it's essentially about a guy who loses everything, family, daughter, home, and it's he's disposable in the eyes of the society he lives in.
So, yeah.
That's what it's called.
Yeah, which I don't want to like make assumptions, but I think going through a divorce and losing your family and stuff and you know, you really believe in that, like all of us do. It's like, I mean, I don't know how you get by that without trying to put that in your work or that just being a part of everything you fucking write after that. You know what I mean? Because it's got to be like one of the worst things that can happen to a guy, I think, you know?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I don't have the comments on my computer. And I was like, oh, shit, man. I just said a ton of shit that would get me canceled where I live. and I just saw somebody just wrote, I'm triggered.
That's right, yeah. Jeremy. That's right.
Yeah.
Everybody, this guy, he's got a cyber fraud thing, so I'm sure he's joking. But everybody, it's pretty cool.
Fucking joke right now. Like, I mean, there's serious things, of course, you know, like, but oh man.
Do you think it's like, I mean, since you kind of touched on it, you said the world's changed and stuff with like, I mean, just all the stupid shit that's going on, like you said, the COVID and stuff. I mean, do you think it's like gonna get back to normal at some point, or is it like forever fucking changed?
Man. I fear that things are forever changed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's, I mean, I think COVID-19 is going to be around. Like originally when this, you know, became a pandemic in my town, when it locked down, they said 2 weeks and now we're in 4.5 months.
Yeah.
You know, luckily I'm an artist and a skateboarder. So I can be alone.
You know, so my life hasn't,
I am an extrovert, But I find myself doing introverted things. So my life has not changed very much, you know, as far as what I do. The money has. I had a good less than a handful of freelance work right when this shit hit the fan that was going to carry me through until the fall. Freelance work and stuff like that. And in like 2 days, it all went away, you know?
Oh,
so financially, things changed, but everything else, not really. But you know, I realized that I have to check my privilege that I was always kind of doing my own thing, you know?
Yeah.
So that hasn't changed a lot, but me and my friends are like big huggers, for example.
Yeah.
We're big high fivers. We're big, you know, someone does something good and you jump on their back, you know, kind of friends.
Yeah.
And I think that is probably, that's changed. I've seen it, you know. I've had the social distance, driveway parties with them, you know, and some of us are like, fuck that, because we're being healthy and safe. But half of us are people like me who don't go out a lot. We work by ourselves. We, you know, shit like that. But we got to respect our other friends. So I feel like in a short time, people are starting to get used to that. And even a couple days ago, I had to go to the grocery store and, you know, I put on the mask and everything. And this family of three got like within the 6 foot distance. And I got pissed kind of. Yeah. Also because my daughter was there. I'm more worried about her, but you know, and then some of my friends who maybe like politically align with me have gone kind of radicalized lately, I feel.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just all happened so fast and people are so steadfast in these, like in this new world, that I don't think we're going to get back to where we were, you know, at the beginning of the year.
Yeah.
And it sucks, and it more sucks. I'm more worried about my daughter than me in that, you know. Like, how is that going to affect her little 8-year-old mind?
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, when I was 8 years old, we were, you know, tearing each other to eat ants off the street, you know.
Yeah.
And now it's like, I go skateboarding and I, you know, as a skateboarder, I fall down a lot. And my daughter's into it now too. And I think like, oh shit, you know, as soon as we get home, she's got to get in the bath. I got to take a shower
because,
you know, there's COVID all over that ground, you know,
COVID's everywhere.
COVID's everywhere. And with the, you know, civil stuff that's going on. I talked to somebody, which I mean, kind of broke my heart a little bit. I was like, you know, as a punk who's a teenager in the 1980s, I thought with civil rights and everything, I thought we'd kind of gotten over this kind of stuff a little bit. And not to say there's not police brutality and, you know, things like that, which should be fixed. Again, one of the reasons why I applied to be a cop. And I was like, you know, I think at this point, this is an opportunity for us to really like fix this for good. Do you think we can? And they're like, no. I was like, well, what's the point then? My daughter's best friends, they're not all of the same ethnicity, and it's, I don't know. I don't think the world's going to be the same.
Yeah.
Because I think a lot of people kind of want to fight, and I see my kid and I see her friends, and they're like, why are things like this? And yeah, you know, I have to tell her historically why things are like this with the social stuff, and also pandemic. I mean, historically, we have a pandemic every 100 years or so, and you know,
yeah,
and so we were kind of due. Our last one was Spanish flu in World War I. But the world changed back then too. And so, no, I don't think things are going to be the same. But I still optimistically think we do have a choice to make them better somehow. They're just going to be different. And right now there's a lot of really bad stuff and there's potential for good stuff. So, but yeah, things are going to be the same.
Yeah. Which that's a good point. You know, you're always in control of your own life and stuff. And, you know, that there's a section of it, no matter how bad things are going, that you don't have to buy into, you know.
Yeah.
You can decide to make things better and make it happen, you know. So, I don't know what's going to happen. I'm just...
I think it's... I don't think we're going to know what happens until next year at some point, you know.
Yeah.
So I think it's up to us to, as artists and creators, to just make fucking cool shit.
Yeah.
You know, it's the power we've got. And, you know, knowing you for a while, Jeff, you know, I know we want the best for everybody.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think it's, we just stay on the path we're on, you know, and it's going to be hard. It's financially hard. I don't know if you guys have taken a hit because of the COVID stuff, but,
well, me not as much, cause my wife finally went to work. So that was kind of nice. And then she ended up working from home. So like, I kind of got a respite from it, but I mean, you know, with all the staying home shit. So I don't know. I'm not making more money than that's before.
Well, I mean, as long as I guess you didn't lose, you know, it's like, you know, I'm still still surviving. It's just things are different, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I hate seeing like this whole thing where they're talking about it starting up again. I'm like, oh, God, I don't want to go through that.
But that's also part of history, you know. It's like with pandemic, like human history. Like I was saying, we have every 100 years or so. You know, I mean, it's what was it been since World War II? It's, you know, it's been
about 100.
Well, it's been over 100 years. So
yeah.
You know, so it's about 100 years or so, and then we had the Black Plague, couple hundred years or 300 years before that or whatever, but in modern human history, it's not unprecedented, for something like this to happen. And the second spike, which is happening now, is also not unprecedented.
Yeah.
Except, like right now we've got these protests that are mostly riots, and so, of course, this new spike is going to be huge, you know. Mm-hmm. And we had that in World War I. The most recent Spanish flu was the first spike. Was, you know, it was kind of like we had now, and then we're fighting a war in the trenches, and so the second spike was huge.
Yeah.
So we'll get over COVID, but World War I changed society. And I think this will too.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I just think we, you know, we gotta be a bunch of good dudes. There's a bunch of bad ones and people opportunists and, you know.
Yeah. And that's a good point too, especially online. Everybody ought to try to be good dudes online. Stop with all the fucking, you know, flipping out over nothing kind of shit.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Spanish flu lasted 2 years, and at the end of the war, Celebration caused the worst second wave. That's what Jan's saying.
Oh, Jan. Yeah. Yeah, Jan's in here. Randy, Nate. Sorry, I've been kind of ignoring the chat, guys.
What up, guys?
Randy, I looked at my phone to see how many people are canceling me because I gone against my previous liberal narrative.
Speaking of canceling Kevin, why don't y'all go subscribe to his Patreon account there?
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
The creator of the 100-day comics.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Soon as he's going to go one tier type deal.
Yeah, going to one tier August 1st. And tomorrow I'm posting a new thing about the new comic, Disposable. And
got to figure out what to do with Monkey Mod because it's done. The first issue's done. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Shoot, if it's done, though.
I'm going to take it to Indiegogo. I mean, this is where my drunk ass speaks up. Take it to Indiegogo, man.
Well, you guys got me considering that. The one thing I don't have done is the cover. So to be fair and honest, the interiors are all done.
Mm-hmm.
The cover is not, but you know.
I'll hear it right there. Kevin's going to come back in a week and he's going to have an Indiegogo set up and he's going to be running his start for a campaign, guys. Come on back. Woo!
Yeah. Yeah, you got to run that campaign for like a month or something. So there's time to do the cover. So.
Yeah, that's true.
But I mean, you know, what would be cool about that, which I don't want to talk you into anything, but it's like, you know, even if it's just a one shot, you know, it's like you get it out and then it's a book on your shelf. Because I hate when I freaking find my old stuff and I go like, God, that was a good idea. Why didn't I do that? You know, it's like in a drawer somewhere and nobody's ever seen it. It's just such a bummer, you know, and no matter what it is, I always think, oh, well, that was good for that time. That was good for whatever. So, you know.
Yeah.
I'd love to see it out.
I'd love for this issue to be a one shot, but it's not.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, you can just say one shot. This is it. Monkey Mod. This is the sum total of all this, you know, these years of working on this thing. This is all I got, you know. Don't expect another one.
That's another thing too. I feel so stupid about because, like, when I started it, I was like firmly, you know, I thought, you know, I was married, I got this kid, you know, we're doing a thing, we're gonna stick by each other, and all this kind of stuff, and then,
yeah.
I don't know. I don't want to make excuses, and I am. So I should just shut up.
Well, you're one of the few guys I feel like could make some legitimate excuses. You know, divorce ain't no fucking joke. So, you know.
No, and I had to move out 1,000 miles away to not be homeless. And, you know, it's like, fuck. So,
what's your normal job as an artist, which ain't the easiest job in the world. So, you know.
Right. Yeah. But anyway, things are a little more... they mellowed out a bit now, and Disposable seems like the better comic to do. Yeah. I don't want to leave Monkey Mon behind. One of the original ideas, I think, in one of the, like, you know, a couple years ago, one of the 100 days I did, I talked about this idea, and it was not when I was divorced, but it was when I was going through the separation. And that was the seed of this comic's idea. And in that I had said that it's a barbarian comic essentially, but it still lives in the Monkey Mod universe. And I still think that, you know.
Yeah. I kind of remember you talking about, I mean, because we used to talk about Conan a lot and stuff, you know, back in the day. After the show, because we're both super fans, and
yeah, totally.
I kind of remember you talking about like some crazy idea, like in the Conan world that like had humor and stuff. I can't really remember what it was. I wonder if that was actually the beginnings of this.
Originally, the idea for that particular storyline was going to be 4 issues, and it was going to be called Monkey Mod the Barbarian.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is basically that story, but a little more personal, still goofy, but less goofy.
Yeah.
A little less 1960s Hanna-Barbera.
That's really cool.
Well, so, I mean, we hit our 2 hours. We go for 2 hours. That's kind of like the theme of the show, is we like try to like get in 2 hours on our comics like overnight. Or, like,
oh, shit. Did I keep you guys longer?
No, it just broke 2 hours. But I don't want to keep you up all night, too. You know, because I don't know what your situation is. So I don't want to like... but I thought maybe I'd just go ahead and wrap it up. I want to say thanks to the chat for coming and watching live. I appreciate it. And sorry I missed going over the ArtCast this time. We'll head over there tomorrow. We'll catch up. Thanks for coming on, Kevin.
Thank you.
Yeah, hit Kevin's Patreon. I'm just going to like assume that's where he wants people to go.
I would love that.
Yeah.
I have to move, and rent's going to be more expensive, and I want to put out comics.
There you go.
So yeah. Go now.
Jump in on this. Give him a little spare time so he can throw up an Indiegogo, make more money.
That's right.
And then get going. You know, that'll fund the next comic. Hell yeah, I'm on board with this idea.
This is how you're going to keep. This is how you're going to keep Kevin Cross around, people. So get out there. Get out there.
You got to pay him for his time. God damn it.
Yeah, have a good one, guys.
All right. Yeah, that's it. I'll see you guys later.